We're changing our profession of faith a little bit, so don't get ahead of me here. Blessed am I, for I have eyes to see, and I have ears to hear, and I anticipate God's power in my life to not just will, but to do His good pleasure in my life. Let's do that one more time. Blessed am I, for I have eyes to see. I have ears to hear. I anticipate God's power in my life. Not just to will, but to do. According to His good pleasure in my life. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Do you believe that?
Yes.
Because if you don't believe it, it's not going to happen. Amen. It will happen.
Yes.
We're talking about being doers, not just hearers of God's word. We're working through the letter of James to the 12 tribes as our template for understanding how to be a doer. So far, our lessons have taught us a few things, so let's review them real quickly. Being a doer, is Christ in you? We spent a lot of time with that, so I'm not going to reinvent the wheel or re-go over it. You know what it means. If we do what God tells us to do, we wind up looking like Him. Just like Jesus lived the law and He looked like His Father. Two, grace is God's word to you. And remember, we talked about God's word or God's grace comes to us in many forms. It doesn't have to be in a verbal word. It can be in an inward stirring. It can be in a song. It could even be in a TV program. It could be as you're walking and looking at nature. God can speak to you. He can influence your heart. Amen? Amen. And that is God's word to you. When God graces you, it's His word to you. You're holding up a piece of paper. What are we doing here?
Just a quick note that these things are right on the sheet, and you can fill it in while it's right there.
Okay.
I know you didn't have time to even notice that because
okay.
You didn't hand them out.
Because I'm hitting the ground running. Number three, God's word to you reveals Christ in you. God's word to you reveals Christ to you. When God speaks to you, remember I said grace is God's word to you. So when grace shows up, it reveals Christ in you. Aren't you glad that God's influence over you doesn't point out the cracks, it fills it in with gold, right?
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And humility is modest reverence towards God. Humility is just modest reverence towards God. Another modesty in regards to the way we conduct our life is just really to see yourself as you really are, to recognize I'm the created, not the creator. Amen. And so I come with a type of humbled respect towards God. Amen. Amen. This is not groveling. This is not feeling terrible about yourself. You didn't make you. God made you. You got nothing to feel bad about. Maybe some of your actions aren't what they ought to be, but you didn't make you. Right? So you appraise yourself rightly and realize God didn't make garbage. And that anything that is not like Christ in me, God changes.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. And so I'm being reconciled, but I can only be reconciled through His grace. And I can't get His grace if I'm not being humble. So I come to Him with modest reverence. Amen.
Yes.
Thank you, Lord Jesus, for that. And it's His Spirit. It's His Spirit that creates and generates that willingness to yield. Amen.
Yes.
You and I both know that there's nothing in us that is willing to yield to anybody for anything, for any reason, if it weren't for God working in us.
Amen.
We are stubborn.
Oh, God.
You know? But you know what? God can break through the stubbornness.
Yes, you can.
Aren't we glad? Pride resists God, but modest reverence invites Him. We'll get to that later when we get to James chapter 4, not today. But in James chapter 4, it talks about that God resists the proud, but He gives grace, His influence to the humble. So if I want to be a doer, I have to receive His grace. And if I want to receive His grace, pride has no place in me.
Amen.
It has no place in me. It lost its hold. It's lost its home. It's lost its foothold in me the moment I bowed my knee and literally with genuine, heartfelt sincerity said, Jesus, You are my Lord. I decided that day, whether I realized it or not, it was a progressive work and a progressive revelation that I have decided to leave pride behind me. Amen?
Amen.
And it expresses itself in thousands of ways. So we're constantly doing this, right? Because we're more filled with pride than we even know. But as we lay pride aside by modest reverence, we wind up being inviting to God. How many of you want to be inviting to Him rather than being someone that is pushing Him away? You know what I mean?
Yeah, yeah.
Amen. I want to be inviting to God. Thank you, Lord. And he's given us that ability. As we behold the word of God, we behold as in a mirror the glory of the Lord. Amen. We're seeing the image of Jesus pointed back at us. As we go to his word, we see who we are. We, you know, that's what that last song is about. We see broken, but he sees mended. Amen. Right? And what God invites us to do is see what he sees. Amen. And what he sees is mended. What he sees is Christ in us. Amen. What he sees is I'm not a smoker. What he sees is I'm not a liar. What he sees is I'm a person that can control the appetites of my body, whether they're sexual or food or whatever happens to be spending or whatever it happens to be. That there's control there because of God's influence in my life. That is what I see. Amen. Yes, what?
Sin shall not have dominion.
It shall not have dominion over us. That's his word, right? God's word about me is that sin will no longer rule you.
Yes,
thank you, Lord.
Glory to God.
I'm so grateful for that. And James tells us these in verses 19 through 27, and we're starting today looking at verse 26 and 27 because we haven't gone there yet. But this is an outline of what these things say. Verse 19 through 27 is listen, believe, renounce, receive, and live as a result. Amen?
Yeah.
Listen. You can't be a doer of something you don't hear. Listen. Believe. Place your trust in it. That requires, you realize you cannot be in a position to embrace if your arms are closed.
Amen.
Amen. If you're protecting, if you are resisting, you can't be believing. Believing is by itself a state of vulnerability before God. Amen? An open willingness in releasing yourself to him. Renounce, the scripture is talking about renouncing sin and wickedness and evil expressions. Receive with a teachable heart God's engrafted word that is like you. It's able to be engrafted in you because you're like him. Amen. You're not going to get an immune reaction when God's word gets engrafted in you because you're like him. And then what's the result of this process? Life. The very thing Jesus promised us, I've come that they might have life and have it more abundantly. Amen? This is where we're headed. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Now, before we go any further, I want to interject something real quickly. In order for us to get the most out of the lessons that James teaches, we need to have a clear view and appraisal of our own heart and our own heart's condition. You need to be honest with yourself. The book of James will not do you any good if you're not honest with yourself. And now it won't. And now that's true about the whole Bible, but it's particularly true of the lessons that James is teaching in this book. If you will not allow yourself, because you're protecting yourself, to have an honest estimation of who you are and where you are without protecting yourself, James can do you no good. But you know what? James is going to do me good.
Amen.
Because I'm not going to protect myself, amen?
Amen.
I don't need to protect myself. I've got a great protector, amen? And he's greater than I am, he's better than I am, and he's able to come in and bring up the things that need to be addressed in my life without condemning me in the process. Yes?
All I need to do is back down and let him do it.
Absolutely. I need to get out of the way, right? I'm going to use the example Terry gave us a couple weeks ago with the two poles of the same sides of a magnet. If you're putting positive together or two negatives together, they resist one another. It takes conscious effort to try to force them together because it's not a natural fit, right? But if you'll just let go and get out of the way, they'll reorient themselves and smack together. They will draw with this intensive force towards one another if you'll just get out of the way. If you'll just stop and let God, he'll do what he needs to do. So now, and a good example of this, let's look at two verses real quickly. One in Hebrews, the fourth chapter. Hebrews, the fourth chapter, looking at verse 9. This, we rely upon God's holy word because he says right here in Hebrews, the fourth chapter, if you'll go ahead and turn there. We're going to read verse 9 through 12. How many of you realize that, you know, you can't, it's hard for you to get an honest appraisal of yourself? Because we really don't even know ourselves all that well. We think we do. But then, you know, have you ever had times when you're in the middle of doing something you thought was with good intention and you realize there's something selfish in the middle of it? You know what I mean?
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
And you didn't even see that. You didn't anticipate that was even in your heart until you're in the middle of the act and then you realize, hey, wait a minute.
Yeah.
There was something evil in there. Or you did something you thought was just to bless a person, but then when they didn't say thank you, you find out that really wasn't the whole reason why you did it. You wanted to be praised. You know what I'm saying? You know, I mean, these little evil things are running around like rats in our heart constantly, and we have something, you know, we often wonder, do I even know my own heart? Well, the answer to that's an emphatic no, you don't. But you're not left like that. Hebrews, the fourth chapter, starting in verse 9, he says, there remains, therefore, a rest for the people of God. In other words, grace. There's grace, a resting from effort. Remember, it was the working of the law that we've been redeemed from. Not the law itself, but you trying to work it out. Amen? Grace is the complete opposite. If it's of grace, it's no longer of works. Isn't that what Paul said? That doesn't mean the results aren't the same. It just means the way I got there is different, right? I'm not striving. There's a rest for the people of God. For he who has entered God's rest has himself also ceased from his works, even as God did from his works. Remember on the seventh day, what did God do? He ceased from his labor. Amen? And if you enter into God's work of grace, you will cease to work even as Christ, God ceased to work on the seventh day. Enter into the rest. Amen? And now what does he go on to say? He says, let us therefore be diligent to enter into that rest, lest anyone fall short after the same example of disbelief, which is another word for actually unbelief, right? Of the Israelites. Verse 12, for the word of God is living and powerful. Powerful. It's alive and powerful. God's word is not void. It is not bereft of energy and power to accomplish in you what it needs to accomplish. It is alive and it's powerful, right? And sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing even to the division of soul and spirit, and of joints and marrow, and is a discerner of what you can't discern, right, of the thoughts and the intentions of your heart.
Right.
You think that might come in handy?
Right.
Right? What is the another example here is in Psalm 139. Let's look at that real quickly before we go back to James. Psalm 139. It's a prayer. It's a very simple prayer. You've heard it before. You probably prayed it before.
Yes.
That David prayed. In Psalm 139, verse 23 and 24. This is the invitation for the word to do what we read in Hebrews chapter 4 just now. He says to God, search me, O God, and know my heart. Why is David asking this? Because he realizes his own limitations. I can't know my heart. He says, search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my anxious ways. And see if there's anything wicked in me, and then lead me in the way everlasting. Notice, even under the law, David had the realization that God is kind and he's merciful. He's not just going to reveal the iniquity in your heart. He's going to help you do something about it. He's going to lead you out. That he usually does not teleport you out. It does happen from time to time, doesn't it, Pam? When God teleported you right out of the years of smoking and just like flicking the switch, it was over. But most things don't work that way. You know, what might work with one person may not work that way with another. You know, God sometimes comes in and just shows off and proves that he's God. And whatever used to plague you just doesn't plague you anymore. And you are totally set free and you don't even know how it happened. You know what I mean? I've had that happen in my life, but I can also testify that most things are not that way in my life. Most things is a journey.
Yes.
And what does he do? He leads me into life everlasting.
Yes.
He doesn't just zap me there. He usually leads me. But so, now he's got the right to do all the zapping he wants to, but usually God's more about the journey. Yes.
You know, that an experience like that is a big lesson, because since then, things have not been easy or so easy.
Yeah.
But it's like, okay, he's there.
Yes.
He did it. Now
absolutely.
It's up to me to cooperate with him.
Absolutely. And God often will do things like that for us for different reasons. For you, it's probably an immovable line in the ground that your mind can't go past this one. I know, I've experienced that God is powerful enough to deal with this. He's proved it to me before. And so in this situation, even if I can't see it, I know from past history he's able, you know, and that, yeah, so God does that. And that's what we were talking about earlier this past year when we talked about memorial stones. It's a good thing to have those memorial stones and go back to them and remember them, but we don't want to live at memorial stones. I want to be creating new ones, right? Because otherwise our relationship's not a relationship, it's just a memory, right? We don't want to live in past victories, we want to live in victories today.
Yeah.
Amen? Yes.
And it's intimate. He wants a relation. That's why sometimes things take longer, but that's why he does it instantaneously sometimes, or he walks us through.
Mm-hmm.
It reminds me of Nathan climbing up in your arms. I mean, that's the way we should be.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
Yes.
We should be seek. Wisdom in us calls us to and stirs us to seek him rather than him having to always seek us.
Yeah.
Right? Okay, so going back to James, the first chapter, we're looking at the last two verses, verse 26 and 27. So we need to have an honest appraisal of ourselves. Amen? We need to have eyes wide open that we might see the things that we need to see. Let's just go ahead and pray that right now. You don't have to pray it with me. Just kind of agree with it in your heart as you can. Father God, I'm just asking right now this morning as we open your precious word. Your word tells us that it's inspired by you and it's profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, so that the man and woman of God may be completely equipped for every good word and work, and that it is a revealer of the thoughts and intentions of our hearts. So God, we open our hearts wide to you this morning and ask you, even as David did, search us, know us, try us, reveal anything in us that is not in voluntary humility towards you, is not in modest reverence towards you, and then lead us out of it into life, Lord. We thank you for it. We're not protecting our hearts, Lord. We trust you to be our protector. It's in Christ's name that we pray. Amen. All right, so let's look at James chapter 1. We're going to look at verse 26 and 27. I was reading something that a brother sent me yesterday, and I wanted to read this before we got started because it's a great segue into this. It's called Give Us a Greater Hunger. And by the way, this man, you may have met him when we were meeting together with a Grace Place a few years back. His name is Mick Fuller, really neat man of God. I really like him. And from the very first day I met him, I liked him because he reminded me of not the way he acted, but just some of his appearance reminded me of Steve Martin, I think it is. Yeah, Steve Martin. He's got the gray hair and the jovial, kind looking face, and he looks a lot like Steve Martin. But he's very born again. He knows the Lord, and he's a wonderful man. And he has it's really not, it's kind of like an assembly of lots of different people that come from different churches. They go out there often once a week on Saturday to meet just as believers out on the beach. I've never been able to participate because of the fact that we're working on Saturdays and it just doesn't work for us. But if you guys are interested and want to, as individuals, to be able to go out there sometime and do that, I encourage you to participate. Very, very, very neat man of God. I love that man. Anyway, this poem is something that he gave, and I'll do my best to try to read it without butchering it the way I read it. It says, give us a greater hunger. Give us a greater hunger, Lord, that we have ever had. Help us wait in one accord until your powers is shown. Noah, keep us, your children, on our knees, beseeching you with mighty pleas, till floods of blessing like the seas sweep over all your own. Give us a sense of urgency that will not be denied. Give us such desire your work to see till ease we cast aside. Give us soul hunger and soul thirst till hearts with longing almost burst. Till we could wish ourselves accursed if souls but reach your side. Lord, now begin your mighty work. Make bare your holy arm. O God, forbid that we should shirk or to this age conform. Reveal your Spirit's mighty power, O come upon your church this hour. By your own working, Lord, in power, till Satan's forts we storm. Help each of us to do our part, O Lord, may we not fail. Give clearest guidance to each heart, till highest mounts we scale. Use us however you may choose. We would no burden, Lord, refuse. But get us, Lord, where you can use and mightily prevail. O send the promised Holy Ghost upon us as we kneel. We need his holy working most till men conviction feel. Lord, this is still the day of grace. Have mercy on our dying race. Revival send to every place. Your miracle reveal. It's written in 1995 by Wesley Duell. So I thought that was a good segue into this because it's all about laying our hearts bare before God and doing your work, do your work, do your work. So
did you make a copy of that?
I will put it onto the website, and I will print one out for you because I know you don't do web.
Oh, I love
so
that.
In James chapter 1, verse 26, if anyone among you thinks he is religious, stop there, because everybody doesn't like the word religion, which is sad because it's actually a great word. The word religious just means devout. Do you think there's anything wrong with being devout?
No.
Those diligently obedient to God's words for outward conduct. That's what religious is. Mm-hmm. Religious just means those diligently obedient to God's words for outward conduct. Well, no wonder James used this verse, because he's talking about being doers. It does make sense, doesn't it? You know, when you look up some of the words, the other words make even more sense than they did before, right? You know? So he says, if any of you thinks he's devout. Oh, gee. I can feel it coming. Because, you know, what you think about yourself is not always an honest appraisal. Right? If anyone thinks he's devout and does not bridle his tongue. The word bridle means to restrain, govern, or control. Same thing a bridle essentially does on a horse, right? To restrain, govern, or control. So if anyone thinks that he is devout, meaning diligently obedient to God's words and his outward conduct, but does not restrain, govern, or control his tongue, he deceives his own heart. You think you're devout, but you're not. Let's read it this way. If someone, I understand I spelt the word deceived incorrectly, I'm sorry about that, but I was not going to make a new slide. If someone thinks themselves to be devoted to God, but cannot control what flies out their mouth, they are deceived about their level of devotion. Yeah, I love James because he just lays it right in front of you. I think he and I would have gotten along famously. Because, I mean, he doesn't pull punches. He just says, you know what, let's just go ahead and cut to the chase. If you can't control what's flying out your mouth, you're not devoted to God. It's that simple. It's that simple. Now already I see on a few people's faces you're already condemning yourself. Is that the reason for this? Did James bring this up there just to make all the people who weren't controlling their mouths feel terrible about themselves?
No,
of course he didn't.
Be a bunch of people not feeling good.
That's exactly right. That was never James' intention. James just wanted us to get an honest appraisal of what's true. If you think you're devoted and you can't control this, you're not as devoted as you think you are. Now let's move forward. Now that we can see where we really are, let's move forward into righteousness. That was his purpose. Are you following? It was not to condemn. Can everybody say that? God doesn't condemn me.
God doesn't condemn me.
The devil condemns you, but
yes.
God does not. So, you know, I want to listen to God, not the devil. I'm done listening to him.
Amen.
He's a liar. Who wants to listen to a liar, right?
It does give you pause.
What's that?
I said it does give you pause.
It does give you pause, but it should not condemn. Amen?
Amen.
One of the reasons why I love this book is because it's a constant verbal splash of cold water, grounding me in truth and making me realize where I really honestly am, so that I can go forward. You can't go forward if you don't know where you are. Amen? And this is also, you need to understand, to some degree or another, every one of us more than likely will still at least slip up from time to time to the day that Jesus comes back, even if that's, if you live another 50 years, you're probably going to continue to slip up from time to time. It will just become progressively less. Are you following?
Mm-hmm.
Now, and that's not to make an excuse for sin, because often we can fall back on that, can't we? Well, you know, I just slipped up once and it's no big deal. No, it's a big deal. You were part of the force that drove the nail into his hand. Don't take it lightly. This is important.
That's right.
I slipped up. Let's just lose that terminology. I sinned. I sinned. Let's call it what it is. See, you know how we use greasy words because it makes us feel better about facing what's actually happening. You know what I mean? Let's call it what it is, because if it doesn't sting, it's not really having the impact it needs to have. Now, did I call myself a sinner, a habitual sin? No, I sinned once, but it was a sin, right? But is God able to not only forgive me, but pull me out of it? Absolutely. I loved a verse that that Nancy shared with me just, I think it was just yesterday, where it says, you know, a righteous man falls seven times, but he gets back up. Amen?
Oh, amen.
No, thank you, God. But a righteous man called it sin when he fell.
Yes.
Are you following? Mm-hmm. He didn't just say, oh, well, I slipped up. No, see, that makes it easy to do. You know, does anybody understand what I'm saying? It makes it easy when we don't call it what it is. You know, when you go to the Lord and confess, he didn't say, confess you slipped. He said, confess that you sinned. Confess that I knew what was right and I deliberately, of my own will, defiantly did something opposite of it.
Yeah.
Call it what it is.
That's right.
If it doesn't sting, you're going to probably be repeating this. Yes?
How about if it just slips out and didn't even plan on saying it?
Yeah. Same thing. Yeah, well, yeah. Yeah. And that's a good point. I'm glad you brought that up. Because what happens when something, quote unquote, slips out of our mouth, it wasn't a planned thing. It's still sin, obviously. But number two, what is it doing? It's revealing something that was already in my heart. Because if it's not in my heart, it can't come out my mouth. Right? What's in the man's heart is what comes out the mouth. Do I still have things that come out my mouth that I wish I realized were not in my heart? Well, of course I do. Every human being. It doesn't have to be cuss words. Sometimes it could just be, you know, you were obstinate with someone. Or you were curt. Or you just weren't kind. All of those are just as bad. Are you following?
I blew it again.
Yes. Yes.
You said something, I want to make sure I wrote it down right. When I sin, I drive another nail into his head.
Well, I'm speaking with metaphorical language. I'm saying, in other words, when I sin, I'm playing part in the crucifixion of my Lord. My sin is what nailed him to that tree. And just because it's already been forgiven 2,000 years ago doesn't mean that as I sin, I'm not part of what that... You realize that the Bible says that every sin that had ever been or ever would be created was laid upon him.
Yeah.
So every time I sin, it's one more of the ones that have been laid on him on that day.
Yes.
He's not experiencing it again. He experienced it then.
Yeah.
Are you seeing what I'm saying? But the truth is, and again, it's not intended to be a condemnation. It's just a wake-up call. If we see it for what it really is, that's all we're talking about. You do understand that. Does it make sense? Okay, so let's read this one more time. If someone thinks themselves to be devoted to God but cannot control what flies out their mouth, they're deceived about their level of devotion. That's essentially what James 1:26 says. Let's just read it in the, I don't think this is the King James, I think this is the Holman version. But if anyone among you thinks he is religious and does not bridle his tongue but deceives his own heart, this one's religion or devotion is useless, without fruit and without purpose. So verse 27. Pure and unpolluted devotion before God the Father is this. Pure and unpolluted devotional obedience before God our Father is this. Visit orphans and widows in their trouble and keep oneself pure from the defiling influence of the world. If I'm really devoted to God, this is what it looks like. It has me doing. I'm reaching out to people that are in need. If I really am devoted to God, I'll find myself doing what God would do. Right?
Yeah.
In other words, my life isn't all about me. It's about setting other people free. It's about honoring God and loving on people. Right? So I'll find myself, this is just an example, orphans and widows. It could be anything. Though you'll find in Scripture, God makes a big deal about the fatherless and the widow.
Yes.
A big deal.
Yeah.
A very, very big deal. And the reasons why is because God so created children and wives so as to, now they can go out and make a way for themselves, but when they do, they're going against their design.
Mm-hmm.
God didn't design them to do that.
Right.
And so when we force them to do that because we don't take care of them, we're participating in their sin.
That's right.
Are you following? And what's he say? He says, you know, if you really have pure and unpolluted devotional obedience to God, you visit orphans and widows. In other words, you're out there ministering to people. You're involved in bringing life, right? And you keep yourself pure from the defiling influence of the world. That's going to look different for each one of us, that latter one. It's going to look different for each one of us. You know, if you're in a position like Stephen, he has to work around the world. Right? So keeping himself pure and unsullied from the influence of the world, he can't remove himself from the world. And you notice God never told us to do that. God never said, God said, come out from among them and be ye separate. He did not say, become a monk. Right? Jesus walked among sinners, didn't he? He didn't hide from them. He also did not call them his close friend. He would interact with them. He would speak life to them. He would tell them the truth about their state. and if they would enter into relationship with him based on truth and commitment to the truth, then he would commit themselves to friendship with them. But if they did not, if he rejected his word, he would still warn them, but he would not befriend them. If you do, the Bible makes it very clear that you have to be careful about who you call your associates because of the fact that it says evil company will corrupt good morals.
Yeah.
I love the example that Brother Bob Allen from West Brandon Baptist gave us at camp, one of those ones that stuck with me. He was a towering man anyway, and he stood up on top of a park bench out there at camp, Camp Flying Eagle. And he had one of the smallest kids go out there and says, "Now come over here and try to pull me off of the bench." And he would struggle with the kid, trying not to let, I mean, he was being genuine about it. And it took the kid a minute, but all it took was just getting him a little bit off balance, and gravity was working more in the kid's favor than in his favor. It's easier to pull someone down than it is to pull them up.
Yeah.
Plain and simple. It's that easy. And you know, God says, you know what, don't put yourself in that position. You speak the word to them, you live an example in them, but you don't continue in a struggle with them, right? Mm-hmm. Remember, we've used the example many times. Jesus went into an area, he preached the word. And I didn't mean just once. He would preach over and over and over and then reveal the word to them, do miracles among them, and then if they would not receive the word, he wiped the dust off his feet and he walked on to the next town,
yes.
Right? Mm-hmm. You are not going to convince somebody into Christ. Now, I'll just go ahead and throw this out there as well. Just to give a little bit of answers to maybe some struggling questions some people might have in their mind about what goes on politically. You know, I personally don't believe it's a right thing for a nation to legislate righteousness. I don't believe that. What we're doing is we're frustrating and forcing the world to do what we often find ourselves incapable of doing. And we make it a law and we say we'll put you in jail if you don't do the right thing. You can't legislate righteousness. God wants a heart change, not character reformation. And all we do is just make them angry. Well, gee, look out your window. They are angry. Why? Because you're trying to force them to do something that they're not equipped for. They're children of the devil. And the desires of their father, they want to do. And they will fight for the right to do it. To the point of killing you, they don't have a problem with that. Because you are telling them, your morality is telling me what I can and I cannot do. And the truth of the matter is, you really don't have that right. We might assume it through government, but we don't have that right. God doesn't even have that right. Does he make you do righteousness? No. He doesn't make you do it. And so you're going to have struggles as long as the government gets involved in moral issues. It's not government's place to make moral issues. When it comes to I'll give you an example, and we'll just do that and move on, okay? When it comes to do with marriage, the government's got nothing to do with marriage. They should not be defining what marriage is, whether it's one woman and one man or whether it's anybody you want to marry. If the government would get their nose out of it and quit giving benefits to people if they marry the way they say they can marry, the issue would be a moot point. In other words, you can marry whoever you want to marry. The government's not going to get involved in it, but we're not going to reward you for it either. We're not going to give you special privileges when it comes to do with insurance. We're not going to give you privileges. Everybody, every man stands for himself. If you have insurance, you have it as an individual, not as a family. And that it solves the problem right there. All the conflict's gone. You deflated it. The worst thing the homosexuals could have ever done was fight for the government to authorize homosexuality as valid. Because what they've done is they allowed the government to put a shackle on them. I'm looking for you for approval to exist the way I want to exist. Which is, don't blame them. We were dumb before them because the church did it first. In fact, we have fought for the right for the government to define marriage as one man and one woman. Why are you doing that? Why are you doing that? If we would get our freaking nose out of it and allow immorality to do its job and let righteousness do its job, God could do his. But we want to go in there and make people do what we want them to do. No wonder they're angry. You would be too. You see what I'm saying? You can't legislate righteousness. I'm going to get off of that because that could get into another issue. But you understand what I'm saying. This is a dangerous thing. If we would pull out of issues of morality. Now, does that mean I'm for it? No, I'm not for it. But I don't have the right to step in and legislate it. Do you understand what I'm saying? And when we fight for this, we make ourselves more, we carry the, what we are doing is Christians are more involved in fighting for establishing righteousness in our nation than they are fighting for righteousness in their own life. They're not willing to even get up early to spend a little bit of time in their Bible before they get into work that day because they're not interested in pressing forward in that kingdom, but they will fight you about gay marriage. Hello? You know what I'm saying? Now, I'm not saying, again, I'm not for these other things. I'm just saying, you know, we're fighting for the wrong kingdom as though we belong to that one. And yet over and over and over and over and over again, the New Testament says, you're not part of this world. Quit putting all your lock, stock, barrel, and hope in this world. You belong to another kingdom. Yes?
Before you change it, the keeping oneself pure from the defiling influence of the world,
mm-hmm.
in my mind, that's meaning, like, if you have a problem with drinking,
mm-hmm.
don't go anywhere near a bar.
Absolutely.
If you have a problem with, you know, sexual thoughts,
mm-hmm.
don't go to the beach.
Yeah.
You know, if you have a problem with whatever,
mm-hmm.
you know, don't go to those areas.
Mm-hmm.
But like, you know, and me, I have to go to work with the world.
Yeah.
But, you know, even though I'm there and they're working on defiling me,
mm-hmm.
it's not keeping me from coming here and making
yeah.
myself pure again.
That's right. And it's, and also it doesn't have to own you while you're there.
Right.
Absolutely. And, you know, this, and again, I'll add one thing to that, and that is that as long as it remains within your control, you ought not be rubbing shoulders with the world anyway.
Mm-hmm.
Other than to, if the Lord wants you to go out and do some type of ministry, that's fine. God wants you to do that. But, you know, even if you don't have a particular problem with a particular thing, it's probably not a healthy thing for a Christian to hang out in bars,
mm-hmm.
more than likely, even if you don't have a problem with drinking. I'm not saying the Lord might not lead you to go there, and I'm not even saying it's wrong to every once in a while go to the one if you want to have a beer. I'm not saying that's wrong. I'm saying I wouldn't hang out in the places where the world kind of congregates. I wouldn't make it the place that I call a frequent stop. Does that make sense to you?
Amen.
I mean, Jesus, when he went through a city, I'm sure he ate at all kinds of places, and most of them probably were not owned by Christians or devout Jews, you know? And, you know, he did not have to drink milk from a Christian cow. You know, it was okay. You know what I mean? It was okay to just to be around the world, but he never allowed his heart to be influenced by it. I had like two or three hands. I'll start with yours.
Zacchaeus.
Exactly.
He's the most worldly person in the entire city.
Mm-hmm.
Where am I going to go eat?
That
your
house. Mm-hmm. It was a commission from God. You had something?
Before you move on, please, I would like you to, for the comfort of those you were talking about, not associating with the world and the,
yeah.
the world's influence, please encourage those that are married to an unbelieving spouse.
Oh, yeah,
and
yeah.
the encouragement.
Well, we've talked about this a lot in the past. But, yeah, I mean, if you are married to an unbeliever, obviously, if they please to dwell with you, God commands you to stay with them, right?
That's
absolutely.
Right.
And it says the unbelieving wife or husband is sanctified or set apart for salvation because of their believing husband or wife. And also, if they were not in that situation, their children would be unholy. But because the believer is there, the children are holy, meaning they also are other than the world. Okay, that does not make them born again, doesn't make their spouse born again. It means that they've got a bias influence living with them 24 hours a day that influences them towards, gives them a leg up that the average non-Christian does not have towards salvation. That's all it really means, right? Now, if you're already married and you got born again, you can't undo that, you know? But and the scripture tells you don't undo that unless they don't please to dwell with you. If they please to leave you, you're free, even to remarry. But if they want to live with you, you need to stay with them. The scripture is very clear on that point. But and there's a lot of Christians that get born again and they have bad teaching, they don't read their word, and they wind up marrying a non-believer, not even realizing it's wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And so it may not be sin for them, but it's still wrong.
Mm-hmm.
And so if you are in a situation to talk with them, then just tell them, you know, hey, I love you, and I am definitely praying for you, but, you know, I have to warn you, like the scripture tells me, you're about to do something that's sin. Because the Bible says that we are not to be unequally yoked with unbelievers. And until you know that this young lady has devoted herself to Christ, I don't mean she said the magic five words, but you know in your heart there's conviction and there's proof in the way that she's convicted in her own life and the way that she lives that she knows Christ as Lord, you have no business putting a ring on her finger. And the truth is also that scripturally speaking, you would be hard pressed to find anywhere where God commands that a marriage takes place and a ceremony takes place for two people to be married. People are married when they make the decision that you are now the only person I'm going to be with, and once you become intimate with them, you're married. Now, if you the difference is if you're a believer with a non-believer, God does not join that marriage because He doesn't approve of it. So you're at that point, and we have an example of that in Scripture. The Scripture shows us in the book it's in the Old Testament. I don't know what the exact reference is, but you can, do your own legwork. Look it up. In the Old Testament, it shows that the Israelites knew the law. They knew what they were supposed to be doing and what they were not supposed to be. They were not, in other words, what they did, they didn't do in ignorance. They knew what they were doing. And they had married and had kids. And when the whole nation returned back to God, God told them, you take your wives and you send them back to their country because you're not really married to them anyway. I never approved of that marriage. I don't recognize it.
Say she is born again and is committed to Christ.
Mm-hmm.
They're living in together,
mm-hmm.
setting up a home. God acknowledges that.
Oh, yeah. If they're born again.
Would you marry them?
I wouldn't. I don't marry anybody. But I would be okay with them being married, yeah.
Okay. In other words, is that living in sin?
I think yes and no. Specifically no. Because the fact that God doesn't give a commandment for a ceremony, it doesn't exist in Scripture.
Okay.
But
so
isn't an appearance of evil to our culture? Yeah. And so are they walking in sin because they're not doing what other people were? If I'm doing something that other people will be offended by because they think it's sin, I'm sinning. So, scripturally speaking, no, it's not a sin. Nowhere in Scripture can you say, in order to be married, you have to have a ceremony. It doesn't exist. It's not there. In fact, remember when God handpicked Isaac's wife, their marriage ceremony was, she went into the tent, they had sex. You're married. There was no ceremony. That was it. That's the way it always was. So, and that traditionally was always God's way. We wanted to finalize it with ceremonies because man likes pomp and circumstance, and God's not against that, as long as it all has some real meaning to it. But that's not what ratifies a marriage or makes it real.
Get the government involved.
We have to get our certificate. But the truth of the matter is that so the Scripture does not require it specifically. It does require it indirectly in that in our culture, if you don't do it, people think you're in sin. And so to avoid the appearance of evil, you need to get out and get a certificate and get married. Does that answer your question? Yes.
Just bringing another level, especially with us trying to learn to be honest and discern the rights and the wrongs of our own hearts,
yes.
is recognizing that in this example, there's probably further sin, even if they were to fall back on, we're both Christians, we both made the decision to be together, therefore we're married. The problem is, up until this point, that's not what's been in their heart.
Yes.
In their heart, they still see themselves as single.
Oh, yes.
They
say that.
They still see themselves as unmarried.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, the logic and the conscience of their heart would tell them, you are not married, you are living in sin, even if you are both believers.
Yeah, absolutely.
And so, until they both made that conscious decision in their heart that we are going to now be married in the eyes of God,
mm-hmm.
they would have been living.
Absolutely, yeah. And one of the things that is keeping from actually hitting the realization of the holy God that we're dealing with is the fact that the one person who's born again in that relationship is living a lie about what's okay in front of her. And so he's blocking the image of Christ, misrepresenting the image of Christ. So we don't realize how malignant sin is. It's dangerous. So I'm glad you brought that up. And I hope that, I know that everybody does, but I'll just say that it's important we realize, and I'm sure that you do, but I'll just say it anyway, this is not gossip. This is addressing an issue with a brother like we were talking about earlier when we're dealing with sin. This is not about shame on him, don't I look good in comparison to him. This is not what we're talking about. We're trying to find out, the question was a refinement question about what do I do? How do I act in this case? And in order to do that, we have to lay out what is this case, right? So that's all we're doing here. Armed as you are, you need to be praying for him. And if you run into him, you need to. The scripture says that when you see them in public, you warn them as though they were a heathen, but you treat them like a brother. Mm-hmm. In other words, you go up to them and say, you know what? The same warning I would give a non-believer, I'm giving you. Because what you're doing is you're living in perpetual sin, and you're spitting at the cross of Christ by doing so.
You know, and where do they stand as being brought together and married as believers and then splitting apart? So, mm-hmm. I mean...
Well, we can address that at another time because it's a good question.
That's a whole nother can of worms.
Yeah, just to throw it out there, because I have addressed it actually once before. I'll just throw it out real quickly, very, very quickly here. I'm not going to linger. If you have other questions regarding it, ask me later. Or put it as a suggestion for something we can have a service on. Because this is very important. It's something that the body of Christ is largely very confused about is what does the Bible say about marriage, divorce, and remarriage? What does it say? This is a problem in Christendom. The Bible tells us that if two people who are in covenant with God and therefore are in covenant with one another, if one of them gets into adultery, that's the only out for a marriage if you're born again. Christians have looked at that and thought, oh, if I know that my husband or my wife has committed adultery in any way, either the physical act or the thought, they look at that as, bam, I can run. And that's not the heart of it. If you want the heart of it, look at Hosea, who continued to chase, and the person had to continue to live for a protracted time in willful, defiant rejection before it would be okay. It's the same way as with God. And if you look at the laws that God laid down in the New Testament for divorce, marriage, and remarriage, the Bible allows a wife to separate, not divorce, but separate from her husband. But a husband is never allowed to separate from his wife. God did not allow that. And the reason why is because who the man represents. The man represents God. The wife represents the body of Christ. And though you and I might be fickle in our allegiance, he cannot and will not be in his. And so the man was never given the right to separate from his wife. Now, if she continues to live in unrepentant adultery, he has the right to divorce her. Just like if I continue to live in unrepentant sin, God can draw the line in the sand and say, you are now a cursed child. We're no longer married. Okay? You see the comparisons. They're very clear. You'd almost have to deliberately not see it to not see it. But the Bible says in the case of separation, if a woman separates herself from her husband, and there better be a darn good reason for it, she cannot remarry. She's still married to him. There is no remarriage unless he has been living in habitual, unrepentant adultery. Are you following? He says the only thing that she can do and the only thing that he can do is either be rejoined to each other or stay separate. But another person is not on the table. Never. It's not acceptable. Now, if in their separated condition, one of them begins to live with another person and think they're free to marry, and this person goes to them and says, I'm telling you, we're still married. The scripture says we're married. You don't have a right to be doing this, and they continue to live in unrepentant adultery for a protracted period of time, yes, you are free to divorce them. And you're free at that point to remarry. Are you seeing the way it's laid out in scripture? But it's not a one-time act and you're like, oh, well, I've got license to go. Now, see, you better be glad God doesn't treat you that way. Because we would all be going to hell in a handbasket.
Yeah.
You treat that person with the same solicitous pursuit and care and drawing to pull them back into reliance and relate good proper relationship with God as long as you can until they finally defiantly put their feet down and say, you know what, I will have none of it. Don't come to me again. Because at that point, they're not only doing that to you, they're doing that to God. And you're free at that point to remarry. Are you following? So that's a very, very short in a nutshell approach to explaining this. And a lot of this is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 7. Just read it, you'll find almost exactly the same words I gave you. Look them up, you'll find they say exactly what I just told you. Okay? But, you know, it's important that we understand what Scripture says. But again, why does Scripture say what he says? Again, it goes back to what we're learning here. It all is, when I do the Word, I wind up looking like Christ. If I do all those things that it says concerning marriage, I'm acting just like my Father. Amen? And that's the reason why it's right. It's because it's his character. Amen? Does that make sense? Thank you, Lord Jesus, that he is. I'm glad that he's given us an example. Amen? So we've ended chapter 1. Let me read that one more time. Pure and unpolluted devotional obedience before God and the Father is this: to visit orphans and widows in their trouble and to keep oneself unspotted from the world. What we're going to start next week is looking at something that is very interesting, because if we look back in the verse before this, he says, if someone can't control what flies out their mouth, they're deceived about their level of devotion towards God. But if we were to look at later in the in chapter 3, which you do remember, these books were not written with chapters, later in his letter, he says, no man can tame the tongue. So he tells us, no one can tame it. But if you haven't tamed it, your devotion is, you're not devoted. There's a reason why he says these two things. He's inviting us towards a surrendered lifestyle, saying, you know what? I can't control my mouth. I need your grace to do it through me. Are you seeing? No. But he says, if you don't control your tongue, if you can't bridle it, then you're not devoted. But you can't control it. So what's the answer? Grace? You're going to say something.
Well, he has control over it. I mean, the speaking in tongues, we have no control.
That's right. Absolutely. And that is a very good thing to utilize whenever you get into a position where you find your mouth wanting to say things it shouldn't